Good morning. How is everybody today?
Good.
Thank you so much for coming out. I know we had high-level competition today, but Senator Moreno pointed out that we had ours scheduled first, by the way. So we're really grateful that you came out to talk with us. I'm State Representative Daphna Michaelson Jenet, and I have the northern corridor of Commerce City, so we're 104th on the north side. And my friend over here, Representative Benavides, has the south side of 104th and all the way down into the core city. And Senator Moreno has all of us. So he's got he's supposed to help us come together. And we wanted to meet with you this morning to talk about some of the legislation that we're working on, what's going on down at the Capitol, and answer any questions or concerns that you might have. And I'm just going to kick it off a little bit, and then I'll hand it over to Representative Benavides, and then we'll over to Senator Moreno, and then open it up for questions. Does that sound like a good plan?
Yeah.
We're all good? Okay. Last week was an interesting week at the Capitol as a freshman legislator. I often make fun and I say hashtag new legislator problems. I had a bill come up and it passed, but I thought it was going to have full support, and it ended up being not a full partisan split, but 20 Republicans voted against my Medicaid communications clarification bill. And I didn't understand it because a little bit later on, a Republican-sponsored bill that was doing similar things to a different part of Medicaid communications passed fully with bipartisan support, and started to learn some of the struggles that we have making sure that we can be heard by both sides of the aisle. So whereas this legislation wasn't particularly, it was impacting a fair amount of our community who is currently a beneficiary of Medicaid and gets confusing communications. So a letter will come in, and maybe you've seen some of the Medicaid letters, and in one letter you might think that you have both been approved for benefits, denied for benefits, and then you start trying to figure out, okay, well, if I've been declined, what is my process for arguing for myself? And it is exceptionally confusing. And you might start a process to argue the fact that you've been declined when you've never been declined in the first place. And then you might not understand the process, and it's going to eat up your time that you need to spend doing other things. And so a simple clarification to the letter, making sure that it is clear whether or not you've received or been declined benefits and how to process a complaint if you don't agree with the letter. That's all it was. And so as a freshman legislator, with other things that are coming down the pike, which I don't necessarily think are too partisan, trying to figure out how to communicate in a way to build that support has been my significant learning for the week. I have another Medicaid bill coming up, and this one is to stop illegal billing. So what that means is, if you are a Medicaid client and you go to see your Medicaid accepting doctor, and the Medicaid, the billing department makes a mistake, and they decline your benefits although you've been approved for benefits, and then they go after you to collect on that debt, that is illegal. There have been some problems in the system. It is already illegal, but we are working with the system not to kick out providers, because we need the providers that we have, but to help work with them so that they get a warning, they get an opportunity to communicate how they're going to fix the problem, and then we escalate from there if the problem isn't fixed. And ultimately, if we have to remove a provider, we remove a provider. But at the end of the day, it's to protect our Medicaid beneficiaries from being sent to collections over medical billing, which was illegal to bill for them in the first place. This one, I feel, is set up a little bit better. I have a Republican co-prime sponsor, which means that it's coming into the House with both a Democrat and a Republican sponsor, and it only has a Democrat sponsorship in the Senate, but I do believe it will ultimately have Republican sponsorship as well. So these are the kinds of things that I'm working on and learning the process, and I'll hand it over to Representative Benavides to talk a little bit about what you're working on.
Thank you. Great idea.
Welcome, everybody. Thank you for coming out this morning. As Daphna said, right now we're in the midst of the session, so bills are just like flying. I serve on three committees, Judiciary, State and Veterans Affairs, and Finance, so I'm seeing a lot of the bills that come through. The bills that I'm bringing, one of them, it was to require prevailing wage on public-private initiatives undertaken by CDOT, and that passed in the House overwhelmingly, and then Dominic sponsored it for me in the Senate, and it died on a party line vote in the Senate. It was an important bill that just codified what CDOT was already doing. So the partisanship is still there because, you know, that's what CDOT didn't oppose it or anything else, but it didn't pass. The second bill that I'm bringing has to do with working people, because in our district, and as Daphna said, I have the other part of Reunion, but I have all of this side of Commerce City, and then I have west of Colorado Boulevard, all the way to Sheridan, there's about six unincorporated areas. And so it goes, starts at Sheridan at 68, and then sort of cuts Catty Corner to 104th at Colorado, and then goes all the way to Tower Road. So it's a pretty good mix of people. And in that district, we have three union apprentice programs. We have the pipe fitters, the carpenters, and the iron workers. And just outside of the district are the sheet metal workers. And so I worked with them, AFL-CIO, as well, on these bills. And this next one I'm bringing is about utilizing apprentices on state-funded jobs. We already use them when there's federal dollars involved in those jobs. But for other jobs, we don't do it as a matter of course. And so this bill would require the state to utilize at least 25% of the project's workforce would need to be apprentices. And why it's important is because CSU did a study that said we are going to need roughly 60,000 construction workers in this state in the next 20 years. And we don't have 60,000 construction workers. So the state has spent a lot of money and pushing a workforce initiatives around apprentice programs. And they're great, but to get to the next level, a journeyman, you have to put in the coursework about 2,000 hours, but you also have to put, or is that the opposite, 2,000 hours on the job, and then the required coursework. So what happens if we're not utilizing them on the job, they're never going to get enough time working in that apprentice trade to qualify and test for a journeyman. So this will allow the state to set an example to be able to utilize apprentices to help get us ready for that next step. So I'm bringing that, and then I have a third bill that's going to be heard in committee on March 13th at 1:30, and that bill is to require an accounting for charter schools. Charter schools, if you didn't know, are authorized either by the district where the charter school is situated or by the Charter School Institute. And they receive the money to operate based on the number of students they have as of October 1st. And they do this based on a contract with the authorizing school district. And in the Charter School Act, there is a requirement to do sort of an accounting for their operations, the money they spend on operations and the money they spend on capital improvements. But there is no real accounting for the students. So however many students they have on October 1st, they get money for. But to teach those students all year. If they don't teach them for the whole year, they still get the money. Even if a student may have left and gone back to a district school sometime during that year. So this bill would require sort of a true up. If you didn't teach the kid the whole year, then you have to pay that back. Now, charter schools do take kids from district schools during the year, and that is credited against any money they may give back. And we've gotten some statistics from education department at the state, and there are some schools that probably do this more than others. Some are online schools and virtual schools, but again, there's no accounting. The best thing that could come out of this, I think, is to encourage all charter schools to really work with their students. Work with them to, if they face academic issues, if they face disciplinary issues, to really work with them and educate them. So that's the main goal of this. And so it would be, all, and the other part of it is the accountability. You know, as government, we give lots of groups money, but we need to account for that money. And there is no accounting for the students that they're required to teach the entire year. So that bill's gonna be heard on the 13th. And I'm working on another bill which would create a cooling off period of 10 days for people that were taken in on what's called a 72-hour hold. If people are going through a crisis, some kind of emotional crisis, and someone fears they are in may pose imminent harm to themselves or someone else, they can call the police or they can take them to an emergency room. And they can hold them for up to 3 days. And they're evaluated by a doctor. And at the end of that period, they are either released or they are sent to some additional treatment. In 2015, there was roughly 30,000 people that were brought in for 3 day holds. And of those, about 10,000 were released in 1 to 3 days. And those are the ones that are concerning, because any of them that have a weapon when they're first taken in, we're currently under the law, the police take that weapon and hold the weapon until they're released. But if they're released in 2 days and they go and pick up their weapon, that emotional crisis is still going on. And so police don't like to give the weapon back because of that. So it would allow them to hold the weapon for up to 10 days in order to give them that cooling off period to maybe go talk to somebody. And unfortunately, it also gives family members or significant others time to go get a restraining order if they need to, you know, before they just give the gun back. So that was, idea came to me from a former chief of police, and it is supported by the chiefs of police and the sheriffs. So I'm hoping that may move forward, and I think it's really necessary. And then finally, I'm working on another bill, which some of you may not know, but I guess about 20 years ago, we built a prison near Pueblo that's these three towers, and it was built as a high security prison, but we've never used it. Just recently, we started using a very small part of it. And there was a study done to renovate that in order to be able to use it. And what they would do is they would bring in some of the paid prisoners that are in paid prisons, where we pay private prisons to take care of them. Some of them would be brought in under this plan. It would also bring in what's called the reentry programs, where when people are gonna get out of jail in 3 to 6 months, they work with them to prepare them for that. And I don't know if you knew this, but the average time in prison is 4 years. So most of the people there are getting out and coming back into our communities. So it's to help prepare them for that. And it's done a little bit in every prison, but this is to do it in one prison for all of them. So it's a higher level. And then the other piece of it is to bring in what's currently at Smith Road at what's called the Denver Regional Diagnostic Center, DRDC. When people are sentenced to prison, they're sent there for 3 to 6 weeks and they're evaluated to determine what prison they should be sent to. And so what this plan is that would be moved to one of the towers there. And that leaves the Smith Road prison in Denver available to bring in what are called chronic sexual offenders. There's because they're not able to receive the treatment they need in order to come back out into society, and they are going to come back out. And there's just not enough providers out in the rural areas. So the plan is to bring them here to do that, and then also to bring in people that are older prisoners that may have some really diseases or other things that need a lot of care. So what my bill will do is to just bring the capital improvement parts, to do some of the renovation at the unused prison the first year, and then to do the renovations at DRDC. So that starts us down the road to implementing that plan. So I'm hoping that would pass too. Anyway, I know I've taken up a lot of time in just explaining that, but I'll be here for questions too, and I'll let Senator Moreno talk about his work.
Good morning. Congressman Perlmutter was also hosting a town hall this morning, and I feel like an airline telling you that, you know, we know you have a choice in the town hall this morning, so we appreciate you joining us. I want to recognize just a couple other elected officials that we have with us in the room today. We do have Paul Solano, our elected RTD district director. We just walked in Mayor Pro Tem Renee Bulla from Commerce City. Mayor Daniel Dick from Federal Heights. And we also have our district director for the South Adams Water and Sanitation District, Michael Scanlon. So based on the partisan makeup of the state legislature, Republicans control the Senate, 18 members to 17 Democratic members. So most of my bills are dead, unfortunately. One of the bills that Adrian talked about that we worked on together was the prevailing wage initiative for state level projects, and reinforcing the federal requirement that we actually pay people a living wage when we're using taxpayer dollars to work on some of these public projects. It was an issue that I simply just couldn't convince my Republican colleagues to go for, but I do believe strongly that when taxpayer dollars are used, we should pay people a living wage. We should not be paying them low wages where they have to then turn around and qualify for government benefits. So that's behind us now, unfortunately. Another initiative that came up in the Senate, I feel like my job is kind of to be the loyal opposition in a lot of ways in the state Senate. We had a right to work initiative that came through the Senate, and I offered an amendment that said, to the bill, that said, you know, if you're going to do this, if you're going to try to do this, then you shouldn't have employers going out there and talking badly about a union. And you shouldn't have them convincing their employees that they don't need to have a union. This is already a federal requirement, but we all know it still happens. And so I offered an amendment to say that you couldn't do that. You can't try to influence your employees that it's their right to decide if they want to form a union. Unfortunately, my Republican colleagues did not accept that amendment, and the bill ended up passing, but not without myself and all of my Democratic colleagues voting against it. And I'm sure the House will make short work of it, because the House is controlled by the Democrats, and Adrian serves on the committee where many of those Republican proposals go to meet a fate that is almost assured. So appreciate all your service on that committee. Most of what's been keeping me busy these days is my role on the Joint Budget Committee. The Joint Budget Committee is a committee of three Democrats and three Republicans, so it's a completely bipartisan committee, three members from the House, three members from the Senate, and right now we're working on figure setting for next year. We're working on setting, establishing the department requests, their budget requests for the next fiscal year. So that's what we're working on right now. The departments have a variety of requests. Many of the departments, knowing the fiscal situation that the state is facing next year, are just asking for the bare minimum to keep their departments and their programs going. There's a couple of initiatives that you may see in the paper that I want to just cover briefly. One was in both the Department of Corrections and in the Department of Healthcare Policy and Financing, which establishes or administers our Medicaid program, there's now a cure for hepatitis C, which is great. Hepatitis C is a terrible, slow progressing disease that you know affects people, and there's finally a cure, which is awesome. And we have been struggling though about what is based on federal law and state law, what is medically necessary for people. And so this is an issue that's being discussed in the courts right now. And the thought is that it is actually medically necessary that if we can cure people with hepatitis C, we should do so. There's one complicating factor in all this, and that's the price of the drugs that are required to cure hepatitis C. The price of those drugs are $48,000 per treatment. It's insane how much they are charging people for this life-saving medication. And so what we've had to do at the state is prioritize. So we've prioritized people with the most advanced stages of hepatitis C. We're curing them first, we're offering them the treatments first, and then trying to figure out what other diseases advance the effects of hepatitis C and trying to cure those folks next. But this is a huge problem, and it's actually led to the lieutenant governor, the new lieutenant governor, Donna Lynn, who, before she came as lieutenant governor, was actually the chief executive officer of Kaiser Permanente in Colorado. So she knows healthcare in and out. And she's developing a slew of proposals, one of which is to require more transparency in how the price of those drugs are established and where that money actually goes. Because $48,000 for a life-saving cure is just, it's unreasonable. And so she's working on a proposal that would establish a little bit more transparency in that, and to really hold these drug manufacturers accountable, and make sure that, you know, we are doing everything that we can to lower the price of prescription medications. Another proposal that she has that we'll be working on is she wants to, right now the state of Colorado is one of Colorado's largest employers that provides health insurance. We have about 40,000 employees that we provide health insurance for. If you increase the number of employees that are in that plan, in that group that you can negotiate, you can then really do some work on lowering the cost of healthcare because you have more people to negotiate prices down for. So she's also asking the legislature to consider a proposal that would allow local governments, so folks like Commerce City or folks like Federal Heights, that they could opt in, it's not required, but that they could opt into the state's health insurance program and expand the number of employees so that we can then drive costs for health insurance down. This is a huge issue, and I know it's something that is not just at the state level, it's also at the federal level, around what is the future of health insurance and what is going to happen if congressional Republicans decide to repeal the Affordable Care Act. What does that look like? What effect will it have in Colorado? I know myself and my colleagues, particularly Representative Michaelson, Jenet on the Public Health Care and Human Services Committee, will really be having these conversations about what does that look like? What happens if the federal government decides to make these changes? Knowing that I think our role, I think the role of the federal government too, but specifically our role at the state level, is how can we make sure that no one loses healthcare coverage with the changes that they are considering. So that's always the baseline for me. I know it's the baseline for many of my colleagues in the House and the Senate, and so we'll be working on that. But I want to leave plenty of time for questions. We said this was going to be an open forum, so literally any question that you have, anything you've seen in the news, anything you want to talk about is fair game, and we'll open it up. Yeah.
I'm John Myers. I have two questions. The first question is, my wife Judy is a para retiree, mm-hmm. and you're facing a bill that would change para's board. What's your position on that, and what do you expect to have happen?
Yeah, great question. So, everyone hear the question? Mm-hmm. Okay. So PARA is the Public Employee Retirement Association, the state's retirement system for our public employees. Right now we have a PARA board, and it is made up of a variety of individuals, one of which the state treasurer is automatically allotted a seat on that board, and he's usually the one that's trying to cause problems, honestly. And so there's a bill running through the legislature now to change the makeup of that retirement board. And what the end goal of this is like, retirees are well represented now. The majority of, I think almost every PARA board member is a retiree because they have stake in the game. They get their benefits, their retirement benefits from PARA. And so this is, I think, a solution in search of a problem. It's not something that I support because at the end of the day, what they're trying to do is add more people in so that they can dilute the influence of retirees on that board so that they can make changes, all in light of they believe that PARA is an underfunded system. PARA has made a lot of changes, has made a lot of modifications, some really difficult ones, to try to make sure that we reach that funded status. And we're getting there. Slowly but surely, we're getting there. But that's not quick enough, unfortunately, for some people. And so they want to change the makeup of the board to try to add more reforms, which I think are not really necessary. But I'll let my two colleagues answer that question as well.
I really have nothing to add. I agree 100% with what Senator Moreno said. And one of the things you might not know is that all members of the legislature are in PARA as well. So it's always interesting to me when we talk about voting against your own interests. We are all PARA members at this point. So it behooves us, beyond just our responsibility to our PARA retirees, which is a significant responsibility, it also benefits us to make sure that we protect PARA to whatever extent that we are able.
Thank you. I also agree with what Dominic said, and that bill, as well as some others, are coming up, and I serve on the Finance Committee, so we are going to be hearing that, and we're also hearing a bill where the state treasurer, who's on the board, wants to be able to have access to everything that they do, which he does in some respects, but this is full access, and he has sort of been this particular treasurer has sort of been a thorn in the side of the board of some of the things he's been requesting. So they don't support that, and we won't be supporting it. There is also another bill to cap the amount the state can put into PARA at the level it is now. And that probably will not pass either. Because one of the things, I attended the JVC hearing that PARA had, and PARA is going to be, I mean, they do recognize that if we can get to full funding sooner than later, it's much better. And a lot of you may have read a story about the judicial division of PARA is the one that's taking the longest to get fully funded. That's the judges that are work for the state. The problem is there's only just about 340 of them, somewhere around there, so it's not a huge division. And because the paper says, oh, that one's doing terrible, that makes it sound like the whole thing is not doing well. But PARA does take their responsibilities seriously, and they have told us that this summer they're going to be doing sort of a listening tour around the state, and for next year they're going to be putting forward recommendations, and they'll come to us in the form of bills next session as to ways to change PARA if necessary. But they're going to go around the state, so we're looking forward to hearing that from them next year.
So one last thing, and then I know you, John, you have another question, I think some of my colleagues on the other side of the aisle believe that we should be at a level of PARA contributions and reserves and money to where we could pay out every single benefit that we have committed to retirees tomorrow. That is not how retirement systems work. That is not how Social Security works. It is you pay in, and people retire, and then new people come into the system. It's very fluid. It is not, and so their allegations that PERA is underfunded are true if you believe that we should be able to pay all benefits to everyone for the rest of their lives tomorrow. That's not how retirement systems work, though.
Second question's a little harder. My view is, always at these town hall meetings, you're seeing people are trying to say, hold your, or do your job. The biggest job of a legislator in Colorado has to be to address the issue of the most restrictive budget and tax limitation in the country. And so my question is, there are a lot of pieces to that, but my question is, what's the plan to eliminate the negative factor for school finance?
So this,
I was waiting for the applause, because that's an applause-worthy question. It really is. It's an applause-worthy question, and now talk about the reality.
So I just want to give a little bit of background so everyone understands what that is. So the negative factor is money that we owe to school districts. So the state legislature has said, hey, really sorry, we can't afford to give you this money right now. We're going to essentially write you an IOU, and eventually we'll pay it back. That the amount of that IOU has grown now to about $870 million, around there. So it's not a
small...
That's
an every year issue.
Every year, yes.
So if you count the total, it's billions.
Yes. So it is not a small chunk of money. The state legislature, a couple years ago, and I was part of this and I voted for it, said that we will no longer allow that number to grow. We will keep pace with inflation and the increasing costs of delivering education to students, and we will not allow that number to grow. In the next budget year, the governor has proposed to allow that number to grow. And it's because of the very difficult fiscal situation and conditions that the state is facing next year. I don't think there's a single person on my side of the aisle who would like to see that happen. So we're the thing that we're trying to do is how can we make sure that the negative factor does not grow, knowing that, you know, it's going to be years into the future that we can finally pay off the negative factor, pay off that IOU that we owe to school districts. But what we can do now, at the bare minimum, is make sure that it doesn't grow. And so that's what we're working towards right now. The governor's proposing to let it grow by about $20 million. We're trying to find that $20 million in the state budget so that we don't have to allow that to happen. Because honestly, even if we did want that to happen, we would have to pass a bill for it because the legislature said just a couple years ago that we weren't going to allow that number to grow. And so we're really working hard to find the money in the budget. But this is difficult. The governor has prioritized, because we had to, in this fiscal year, we had to dip into the state's reserve because we just didn't have, revenues were coming in lower than we expected, and so we had to dip into the state's reserve. The reserve is required to be at 6.5% of all of state expenditures, and that's in law as well. So we dipped into it a little bit. We said, hey, we have hard times, we're gonna dip in a little bit, and then we'll work to pay it back in future years. The governor has prioritized repaying all of that money next year. So that's above $200 million. And so it's a sizable chunk of money that we're talking with the governor's office to say, hey, is there a way that maybe we repay some of those funds back in a future year so that we can use some of that $200 million to fund really important programs like schools, like paying down the negative factor. I will say in this fiscal year, a variety of things happened. Student enrollment was less than projected. So we have fewer students than we thought we did. And then the number of at-risk students, which is a population of students that gets an additional allocation of money because it's harder to serve those kids than some of the others, those numbers came back lower than we expected too. that would have allowed that would have allowed the state to use that money somewhere else. But instead, we said, no, we are going to continue with the original projections that we made, the original appropriation that we made, and we're not going to divert those funds despite enrollment coming in lower than expected. We're going to continue to give that money towards schools. So that allowed us to spend down that negative factor $2 million. So instead of $870 million, it's now $868 million. I know it's small, it's a small drop in the bucket, but it does show the legislature's commitment to buying down the negative factor and doing so as quickly as possible. Guillermo.
The balance of building new buildings for old schools, the growth builds brand new schools for high tech and everything that you need in the communities in that area raise those funds in a sense to meet the demands of the kids that are coming in. The old areas have all these 50, 60, 70-year-old schools, and that's statewide. And that's what some of the funds were supposed to have been used. But we haven't seen it. And it's not $800 million. You're looking at $2, $3 billion easy statewide. And we don't see any relief. But yet we keep complaining about education, okay, when new populations that are moving in from heavens knows where, okay, come into a brand new home and a brand new school, okay, and the ones that have, let's say, built the foundation for this to happen on cities growing, don't get anything. The balance of educating is not there when it comes to funding, building buildings to meet the demands of the future.
Yeah, so just on the, obviously a lot of schools have aging infrastructure where they're, most of the schools that I went to here in Adams 14, were built in the 50s. And some literally have, I mean, they have leaks in the ceiling because they can't afford to repair the ceilings in the schools. A couple of things on this. We have a pot of state dollars called the BEST program, the Building Excellent Schools Today program. And that money, the money that comes to fund that program, is actually from marijuana taxes. So it's the marijuana excise tax is funded into that program. And it's about, I think, $40 million that goes into that program. But it is a grant program. And so school districts have to apply to the BEST board, and they have to provide them the list of projects that they need in their school, and then that BEST board awards grants. The problem is that the BEST board awards grants to the entire state. And as we know, there are urban districts, there are rural districts, all of them have needs. And so that $40 million that we gave them for marijuana taxes is a drop in the bucket compared to what's actually needed. Guillermo's right, it's probably in the billions of dollars about what school buildings need. And so the big question is, how do we try to fund more of that money, knowing that the state's in such a difficult and dire situation where every dollar that we do put towards capital maintenance, to if a school needs a new boiler, if the school needs a new roof, that's one less dollar, honestly, than is gonna go towards school instruction. And giving schools the money to actually operate the schools. And so it's a difficult question that we do struggle with. An interesting proposal came from the Douglas County School Board, actually. And they're asking the legislature to explore an issue where they say, hey, what is, they're looking at the issue broader. And they're saying, why do we need new schools? It's because developers build a lot of homes because a lot of people move here. And what are the developers doing to contribute towards the cost of building those schools? It depends. Some schools have relationships with their developers where developers do pick up some of the tab of building those new schools. A lot of districts don't. And so we need to do a better job at encouraging districts to work with those developers. Douglas County is asking the state legislature to look at a state law that would require developers to build the cost of new schools, rather than the taxpayers in that district rather than property taxes from the local taxpayers, because it's developers that are building the new homes and that they expect new schools to be built in order to sell those new homes to new people moving into neighborhoods. It's an interesting proposal, and I think folks are looking at it down at the state legislature, and hopefully it's a conversation that we can have around what's the appropriate level of involvement for developers in building some of these new schools.
Thank you. And let me just add a little bit to that, is that part of the problem is not just the schools and Amendment 23 that helped create a negative factor that we weren't able to put the money into school, but there's also the Gallagher Amendment and Tabor overall. Yesterday, actually, one of our House members, Millie Hamner, she lives up in the mountains, but she's on the JBC, and she wrote an article in the New York Post that says, you know, basically, in good economic times, we should have the money to do some of these things. But because we're constrained by Tabor, we can't do that. We end up having to give refunds back instead of saving that money or using it for those needs. And until we are able to fix that, which I'm not sure we are going to be anytime soon, although there is a proposal, surprisingly, by a Republican that we'll be evaluating in the Finance Committee, which would raise the cap level for Tabor, which might bring us an extra $100 million or so a year, which is some relief. It's not enough to do all the things we need to do, but where we sit right now without that, we can only sort of keep the status quo going, because any money we bring in above that, we have to give back in refunds. So it's a continuing problem, and until we're willing, excuse me, to bring that to the voters to get rid of it, we're gonna face that. Even if it's, I know a lot of cities and counties have debruced, and you know, even debrucing for major areas, the only areas that we can sort of debruce are enterprises now, and you all know last year they attempted to get the hospital provider fee to make it an enterprise so it was exempt from Tabor. That would have brought in roughly $200 million a year, and the Republicans opposed that. And there's consideration this year, but nobody thinks it will pass through the Senate, so I'm not even sure it'll be brought. So we're kind of hamstrung, and I know I've heard Dominic talk about the Gallagher Amendment, and I know he does a much better job than me, but I'd like him to tell you about that and what that might mean for schools and also for the budget that we're going to have to pay for.
So I'll go over just really quickly what the Gallagher Amendment is and how it's going to affect our budget both at the state level and locally next fiscal year. So the Gallagher Amendment was passed by voters back in the 1980s. And what it said was we want to keep a certain level for commercial property taxes and residential property taxes in order to fund local districts, like school districts, water districts, fire districts. And what the Gallagher Amendment said was that number for commercial property tax always has to be 55%. And from residential, it always has to be 45%. And it was always meant to go up and down. When times were good and property tax revenue was coming in great, it would go up. When property tax revenue went down, it would go down. The problem that we have is when then Tabor came into effect in 1992, is that it said, now you can only go down. Because if you go back up with property tax, that is a tax increase, and you have to ask voters for that. So the result is that Gallagher, the residential assessment rate, which is the property tax evaluation tool that we use, back before Gallagher, it was at 21%. Today, it's at 7.96%. And for the next year, because we're out of balance, it's scheduled to go down to 6.56%. What that means is that school districts across the state will lose between $130 and $180 million locally. And that's not even saying what it's going to do to water districts, fire districts, cities. All of those entities are going to lose money because we have to lower the residential assessment rate because Gallagher forces us to. So there's a lot of talk about at the state capitol about what can be done. Now, schools are in a little bit of a different situation because we have a state law that says if you lose money at the local level, if your local revenues come in less for school districts, the state will backfill that. So that means the state will have to find that $130 to $180 million for local schools. We don't have a similar law for cities or for fire districts or for water districts. And so they're just going to be out that money, and we're going to have to figure out what to do. I was just talking to the fire chief of the fire district here in Commerce City.
South Adams,
thank you. I was going to say North Metro, and I was like, that's not right. South Adams Fire District, they are going to lose $1 million through this. And they, I don't know if you all just, I just got a mailer. They just, because of all the improvements they've been making, they've been able to lower their ISO rating, which actually means that we do better at a local level for fire protection services. And so they're going to lose $1 million. And so we're having the conversation at the state level about what can we do. I don't think anything can be done on Gallagher before that effect takes place, before that reduction takes place. The state constitution, Gallagher says, you have to lower the residential assessment rate. If we didn't do that as state lawmakers, we would be in violation of our oath to uphold the constitution. We will have to put something before voters, though, to let you all make the decision, because you're the only ones that can make changes to the state constitution. And so that's something that we're having a talk with about now. This issue is a little different from the Taxpayer Bill of Rights from Tabor. Tabor has really become a purity test on the Republican side, and if you don't support Tabor in whole, then you're not a real Republican. But Gallagher is different. Gallagher is different. They don't like Gallagher either because it taxes businesses, property tax, at 3 times the level as residential tax. And so that's where you get Republicans. Republicans are like, oh, I don't like that businesses are taxed more than average taxpayers. And so there's hopefully some bipartisan agreement on what can we do to make reforms to Gallagher and put something before voters so you all can decide how to reform that piece of the state constitution.
Do you want to talk about the levy?
Do you want me to?
You don't
have to. Okay. I'll bring it up in a bit.
Okay.
Yeah. Renee.
When they do come up with this compromise, is it possible for the Democrats to throw in something with Tabor because of the fact that we know what Tabor is doing to the state, and they know what Tabor is doing to the state, and being even a pure Republican, you know that if we start giving back refunds, when the refunds hit a level where you're getting back $1,000 a year, nobody's ever going to vote to do anything with Tabor, and our state's going to go bankrupt. And if by chance they do something with recreational marijuana's brought in $1 billion to this state. Not all of it. I think we should see more of it in the government and being able to, instead of just $43 million. But can we make a compromise? Say if we're going to work on Gallagher, we have to work on Tabor at the same time.
I think it's a great question. I think the two do go hand in hand. The problem is that you cannot structure a ballot initiative that way. When Tabor passed, Tabor was not about just voting on your tax increases. That was actually the smallest piece of what Tabor was about. Tabor was designed to shrink the size of government. That's what it was designed to do. And so it developed all these mechanisms in place to do just that. Everyone was like, oh my God, we can never have this happen again. We were duped once, we're not gonna be duped again. Let's pass an amendment to the state constitution that requires single subject from now on. The problem is that now that Tabor's in the constitution and we passed that single subject rule, if you wanna make changes to Tabor, it's gotta be piece by piece. You cannot do a whole scale repeal of Tabor. Just like you cannot do a whole scale repeal of Gallagher. So we couldn't put a thing in front of the voters that say, hey, will you fix this piece of Gallagher? Oh, and also fix this and Tabor. That's not allowed. It can only be one small single subject that you fix at a time. And so the two, although they are connected, we cannot put an initiative in front of the voters that allows them to fix both at the same time. So the Gallagher piece will have to come separately, and we'll have to have that discussion separately. And then Tabor is a whole other animal that we'll have to have another discussion about. The next fiscal year, we are scheduled, the state budget is over that cap that Tabor establishes. We are scheduled to send back over $200 million back to taxpayers. That's $200 million that we could use to fund schools, to fund roads, to do a variety of things, but we have to, pursuant to the state constitution, send it back to taxpayers.
Or ask to keep it.
You're absolutely right. We can ask to keep it. That has to be a decision by you, all the voters, though, too. So as a result of that $200 million, you know, this has happened a few times in the past. The state government was over our cap, and we had to send back refunds to taxpayers. It happened 2 years ago when I filed my state income taxes. I got back $12. It's not $12 I needed. It's $12 I'd much rather go to schools or to roads, but I got it back. So you will, unless we can figure something out, you all will get a refund on your state income taxes next year. I encourage you, what I did with that $12 is there was a variety of programs that you could donate to. I donated all my $12 to the Public Education Fund. But unless we can figure something out, that will happen again, and it'll be a small amount that taxpayers get back, unfortunately, unless we can figure out a solution to this.
One other thing about this. In the times that I've lived here, and in the times that you have as well, you've seen initiatives come before us to vote on to get rid of pieces of Tabor, and we haven't been able to close the deal. And part of that is turnout, right? The people who would vote against Tabor, who are disproportionately impacted by Tabor, don't necessarily turn out to vote. And all I can say is if we really want to have some impact, we all have to work together to get as many people as possible out to vote, period. Question over there.
And just one last thing that Daphne said. Tabor actually, literally, I'd say that it was booby-trapped, because it was. It requires that any changes that you want to make to Tabor happen in certain years, odd years, where there's less voter turnout. So it was a variety of things that Tabor required to protect itself, done by evil genius Doug Bruce, who went to jail for tax evasion. But that's a whole other subject.
Oh, brother.
So I was going to say, I think you had your hand up back in the back, and then you two in the front.
I just wanted to let you know personally, I know of five bills that are negatively impacting Tara, and I remember when Tara was overfunded and legislated back to the state of prior to 2008, which made it that much more difficult to get funding on their backup. And I want to know if the $12 you donated was counted under Tara.
It was not counted under Tabor because the Public Education Fund is a separate entity that is Tabor exempt.
Good question.
Yeah. I didn't even think about that, actually. Yeah.
Hi, my name's Jenny Davenport, neighbor. And I brought my daughter with me because this is her first time experiencing something like this, so
awesome.
Thanks for coming out. As a parent, healthcare is extremely important to us. My husband was interested in the apprenticeship programs that you were just talking about. But as an educator, and I've been in education for several decades, charter school, public, private, all of that, I'm very interested in the BEST program that you were just talking about, and about, this is Mr. Guillermo, his comments, about some of the schools with struggling infrastructure accessing money so that they can take care of things more immediately than what the process will let them do, talking about Tabor and all of that. So who's eligible, in other words, to apply for that? Charter schools, private schools, all of that?
Great question. Anyone is eligible, except with the exception of private schools, because they don't receive taxpayer funding. charter schools and public schools are all eligible. And like I mentioned, the challenge there is that the need so far outweighs the funding. And so Mapleton, a district just next door to us, did get some of the best funding and were able to replace some of the equipment in their buildings. So for schools, and any of you that work with your school, local school district, encourage them to apply for the BEST program, because it is that money is there to assist local districts with any needs that they have.
Perhaps in the future, because you talked about several bills, perhaps in one of your future town hall meetings, you can bring to the group the current status of bills. It comes out every Friday, and that would help me track your bills and where they are. But in terms of all of these budget issues, we haven't even talked about transportation. And our roads are falling apart. And pretty soon, we're just gonna have trails to drive on. And so, although we laugh, how are we going to resolve that very important issue?
Great question. So a while ago, the legislature passed a bill, Senate Bill 228. And it said when the state revenue, when the economy falls into a certain threshold, we will divert certain transfers to transportation. This year, I think that amounts to about $70 million. So the state it's about 68. But the state is giving money to transportation this year. Next year, we are scheduled to give about $160 million to transportation. The governor is proposing, knowing that we're already facing such difficult times with our state budget, he is proposing to cut that amount in half. So instead of $160 million for transportation, we'd only give $79 million. It's a difficult conversation to have, because many of my colleagues on the Republican side of the aisle very much are supportive of transportation funding. And that's kind of how we bring them along, is, hey, what can we do for transportation? They're willing to have that conversation. I am so surprised, actually, that they have not yet shut down a conversation about an additional tax increase for transportation, because they know how important it is and they want to do something about it too. So those conversations are happening currently between the Speaker of the House and the President of the Senate to see what can be done. What does a tax referred measure even look like? Knowing that the legislature doesn't have the power to do that, and asking the voters if that's something that they'd be willing to consider. I can almost guarantee you that it will not be a gas tax. The gas tax hasn't been raised in over 20 years, but it is, from everything polling tells us, it's wildly unpopular to try to raise the gas tax. If you think about it, people are very sensitive to the price of gas. Some people will drive miles down the road for 10 cents off a gallon, which doesn't really make that much sense, but they do it. So they're very price sensitive to that. I don't think that they're going to support something like that. And also, we have the added problem of the gas tax is a dying tax. Vehicles are becoming more fuel efficient, so you don't have to refuel as much. And so we are not bringing in as much revenue as we'd like in that way. They're looking at maybe a sales tax increase from the state level to address some of our transportation needs, is what I've last heard about those conversations.
I think Paul.
Go ahead.
I'm Paul Solano. I live in South Commerce City, and there's been a lot of talk. The advocacy group Ditch the Ditch wants to reroute through Commerce City. And they have stated they're going to take their issue to the State House. Where's that going?
Yeah, okay. So many of you may be familiar, but CDOT is working on a solution to central I-70. So basically I-70 between Colorado Boulevard and I-25. The current proposal is to underground that highway and to expand it. So to actually get rid of the viaduct. There are some people in those neighborhoods that don't want the highway in their backyard anymore. I don't blame them. They were subject to it back in the 60s, and it basically ran through their neighborhoods back then. And I have every bit of compassion and sympathy for the people that live in that area. But their solution is to put it through Commerce City. So to put it through 270 and I-76, which I don't think is a real solution. Because the reality is the same arguments that they use, that this should have never been done to a low-income Latino community, totally agree. But your solution then is to reroute it through another low-income Latino community? That's not a real solution to me. And so I've been very clear with them about that, about my position on that. I do think there's room to have a conversation between Denver and Adams County, which are the two counties that this would affect, to talk about, okay, what are some innovative alternatives, right? Because their whole issue is that we're gonna expand a highway, and with technology moving the way it is, with perhaps autonomous vehicles coming out, we may not actually need that capacity, 10, 15 years from now. I think that's a conversation worth having. I'm willing to sit down with them and talk about what that looks like. But if the conversation is just about rerouting I-70, then I think we're actually missing the conversation. And you're just then pushing your problem off to another community, which isn't a real solution.
May I be rude and interrupt you? If they reroute to the north, it would cost three times as much and will not be successful.
Mm-hmm.
It
yes.
will not work. It may be very unfortunate, but that really is the only solution.
It's perfect, yes. And 270 can't handle the traffic today.
Exactly.
And so to think about rerouting an entirely congested highway through an already congested highway, I don't think it works.
And I think there's pretty much unanimity from the Adams County legislators, but on the other side, we're always willing to sit and talk, and some of the Denver legislators have asked us to sit down and have those meetings, and we're willing to do that, but I don't hear, and we've had some discussions with county commissioners, that I've not heard anybody willing to say move it over here. And the whole discussions have been going on since about 2003. And the people in Denver have changed, the different activist groups in the neighborhood and others. And I agree wholeheartedly with Dominic that, the problem is that highway should have never been built where it was, but it's there, and that's the problem. And it more recently, it became more of a pronounced problem because Denver also feels that the drainage issues, they need to build a water system thing over at City Park neighborhood. So now you're impacting another neighborhood. So that has brought the conversation back up in Denver. But again, the answer is not coming to Adams for that. But if you hear that we may be meeting with them, I think we're all pretty strong in our position that we don't want it over here, but we're not going to say no to meeting with people.
Right.
So, and you had a question.
Back to the transportation funding. I mean, obviously that transportation infrastructure is critical to our economy. I'm really glad to see that the General Assembly was going to get serious about taking it on.
Yeah.
But the funding part does worry me. To me, a gas tax is still the most logical one because the people who use it pay for it. And if we go to that sales tax well to fund this one, when we get serious about the negative factor, that well is going to be dry.
Yeah.
And then what's left?
Is there was a group last year that met and did some polling, and the polling said people were more amenable to a sales tax increase as opposed to a gas tax increase. And part of the problem with the gas tax, when Dominic, I think, referred to it as a dying tax, it's down about 30% of where it should be, and it does go to the efficiency of the vehicles and many vehicles that don't even use gas. So it wouldn't be a sustainable gas or tax for us for the transportation needs that we have. There is, CDOT is doing a pilot program right now on about 100 vehicles in the state to do sort of a vehicles miles traveled type of determination, and that would be a part of the gas tax. There's some problems because it's been tried in other states, and they put things on your vehicle, and some people don't want them to do that, although GPS is pretty much on everybody's vehicle, whether they know it or not, you know. But those are some of the issues, and when they get more information, that will be helpful as well. But there has been at least two federal task forces that have come out with using the vehicle miles traveled basis on the gas tax, as opposed to just raising what we have now. We still won't have the funds that we need. I know the truckers here in Commerce City also proposed increasing the ownership tax that we pay on our vehicles and things. I know that's in consideration, but it's not, you know, it's hard to figure out which tax do you take to the voters to increase, you know. So they're having those discussions, and I know Republicans have said they're open to it, but they're struggling on their side too, because some of the Republicans have said, we'll only increase a tax if we decrease it other places, because they felt, some of them, not all of them, have felt that we have enough money in the state budget by getting rid of other programs and using that. But what other programs do you get rid of? Just from our conversation, most of the things that we're spending our money on are roads and schools and prisons. You know, so what kinds of things that are extra do we get rid of to do that? So that's part of the conversation as well, and why it's such a difficult conversation.
Not to change the subject, but the word illegal, okay, in perspective to what's happening now from the feds, as a state or locally, can we ask for transparency from companies that utilize federal funding whenever they are caught hiring illegals? The problem is, that's where it's at. People come over, they're offered the job. Yeah. They send those people back, but the companies are free. But yet all the issues that come with that hiring stays with local government, cities, schools, everything that coincides with it, divorces, police, that.
That's the question.
Yes, the people do not, the people, the legislature from the feds all the way down to whatever, don't ask for that transparency from these businesses, and how do they get penalized? There's got to be a penalty for that other than what is there. I don't know how that can be done. If the feds can't do it, then state, possibly, to ask, okay? Okay, give us your data on how many of the workers that worked here were illegal, and you hired them for 20, 30 years.
Well, and just to go back in history, because this is something I've worked on for a number of years, is back in 1986 when they changed the immigration laws and put some of these requirements, because some of you like me remember when you applied for jobs, you didn't always have to have all these documents, the I-9 or none of that was around before. Those started back then, and when they put those labor restrictions in place, they never did any enforcement on them at the federal level. And under the Constitution, the federal government regulates immigration reform. And when states have tried in many ways to, on their own, initiate laws in their state, they have been knocked down by the courts because the Constitution says that the federal government regulates immigration. In fact, we heard a bill that was brought just this week. Our committee met till 12:30 at night to hear a bill that wanted to make local, state-level officials personally liable if they passed a policy, ordinance, law, said that their employees would not cooperate with immigration authorities. And this was because of, there were witnesses, it was very sad in that people were killed because, say, of a drunk driver, and they had been released and ICE had not picked them up. But part of the problem with local governments and their police departments, no sheriff anywhere in the state are abiding by ICE detainers, because that tells local police and sheriff's departments, once this person is free to leave or on bail or finish their sentence, you need to contact us and let us come and pick them up. Well, there's been a lot of court cases and at the Supreme Court level that say that's a Fourth Amendment violation, because there has to be probable cause and it has to be individual.
I understand that, and I know what you're trying to explain. I've heard it for 20, 30 years, okay? But the problem is not solved. It's moved on, and pretty soon I'll be participating in stuff like this for almost 40, 50 years.
Okay. And I agree with you, Gamma. It's
what
not.
What I'm saying is, this is a problem that has, it comes from the president on down right now. And he himself knows what he's got in there and has become a billionaire. But all those people has cost states, local, and state millions and billions of dollars, okay? Every time you send somebody over there, they don't produce, but they left all their problems here.
And I was attempting to.
If his state, okay, his cabinet that he was trying to get, and you find that in there, it was in the news. That one guy that they didn't let come in because he hired people, yet he wants to send these people back. Okay?
And I'm agreeing with you, but I'm saying that states cannot impose those laws. Under the U.S. Constitution, only the federal government can. And when states have initiated laws like that, they have been knocked down because they do not have the authority to do that. And if you look at some of the president's current executive orders and implementation orders, one thing that's missing in there is any enforcement against employers. And I know that Congressman Bennett, about 3 years ago, worked with a bipartisan group of legislators to have comprehensive immigration reform. It was passed at the Senate, and at the House, the Republicans never introduced it, so it never passed. So the federal level isn't able to get anything passed, and so those problems continue to exist. And what the president has done so far would not address the employer's culpability that you're questioning, and states cannot do it. But I don't think it's proper for states also to try to hold, say, politicians, local mayors or others personally liable for those things as well. And there will be other state laws that will probably be proposed that we may have to say they're unconstitutional. We cannot support that because it'll get knocked down and we'll be spending all our limited money also representing ourselves in court. So that's not the answer. And I do agree with you is that part of the problem with bringing people without documents into this country is for labor. We need that. And if what what the president is doing now, it's causing a lot of fear in communities. And that doesn't help any of us. Because if people are unwilling to call in and talk to a police officer or be witnesses, it's not going to help. Our safety is going to be hurt. Actually, one of my colleagues from Boulder spoke to this at the hearing we had this week, is that there was a woman, and I can't remember her name, who was killed and her one-year-old were taken, and her body was found in parts in suitcases. It was in the paper in the last couple of weeks. But when they tried to get information about that kidnapping and what happened, people were too afraid to talk to them. They wouldn't tell the police what was going on. So it took longer to find them And as a result, this woman was killed in that. So it doesn't help us to do that. It's not going to help us this summer if nobody shows up to pick the crops around the state. You know, so we have to look at a way to do this and let our federal legislators know that.
Well, one quick thing on this, Guillermo. A policy that has been introduced in the past at the state level is e-verify. So it would require businesses to verify that their employees are citizens, that they are eligible to work. The one problem with this bill has always been, and the reason I voted against it when I was in the House, is that the penalties that come from in that proposal have always been on the employees. They've never been on the employers. And so they penalize people who are just coming to this country to try to make a living and provide for their families, and they're not actually holding the employers accountable who attract these employees, who say, you know, come here, come work. And by the way, we're going to pay you lower wages than anyone else deserves. So that's been the issue all along, is that the employers have not been held accountable. If that was a piece of it, I could support it, but that hasn't been a piece of that before.
On a more cheerful note, I just wanted to answer the question of the man in black hat there. The League of Women Voters publishes this every 2 weeks. It lists every single one of the Colorado things that are in front of
the bills.
There you go. And at the back, they have a list of what the position of each one of the bills are. It can come right to your house for only $20 a year. I hope that's not an aggravation.
thank you, Anne. And pointed in, I'll bring status sheets next time for everyone. But that's a great resource because what that gives you, that status sheets do not, is it tells you how people voted on each of the bills, which is, I think,
really
useful.
Important.
Yeah.
I'm just going to say with the speed that I've seen some bills go through, that a 2 week publication
So if you are on the internet, the new legislative website is very useful. So for those people who are on the internet, ledge.colorado.gov, there is an incredible search tool. You can search by topic, so you don't have to weed through all of the bills. If there's something in particular, like transportation, that you're interested in, you can put transportation into the search box, and all of the bills that are discussing transportation will come up with their sponsors, with the committees that they're being referred to, and all of the contact information. And I highly encourage you, if you have an opinion on a bill, that you reach out and let that legislator know whether or not that's your legislator. And you may also reach out to the committee members that it's referenced to, because, for example, Representative Benavides and I sit on finance together, and we meet and we discuss all of the bills and we go look through the nuances. And sometimes if a bill is a good bill that's poorly written, we help amend that bill so that it can continue to go through. But we take the email correspondence that we receive from our constituents into consideration when we discuss those bills. So leg.colorado.gov, very useful website.
So we have time for one more.
Last question.
Thank you. In the topic, change the topic back to medical marijuana. There's talk the Department of Justice wants to come down on recreational marijuana in 6 states, and Colorado's been mentioned as one of them. We voted for recreational marijuana as people. So how does that work? How does the federal government kind of supersede our choice to have
states' rights, my friend?
Pardon me?
I said states' rights.
I mean, it's a great question. At the end of the day, federal law always trumps state law. So if they want to come in and they want to shut down the marijuana operation that we have in Colorado, they could do that. Now, that wouldn't come without plenty of resistance from elected officials like myself who say, our voters voted for this. Like, this is, they voted to have this, and this is a state's rights issue. This is an issue that we, and I think we're now at a critical mass of states that have decided to do the same thing, that they're going to put up the same resistance. So, although we don't have the most influence over this will be in the camp of our congressional representatives and our U.S. senators, you will see the state stand up and say, we are going to abide by the will of our voters, and we resist any attempts to shut down this legitimate operation that our voters have approved of.
And to add to that, we're one of the few states that have marijuana in our constitution. So our attorney general will have to support our constitution. So anything they do will be challenged in court. And our state's right is based on the 10th Amendment of the U.S. Constitution that says anything that's not regulated by the federal government can be regulated by the state. And that's where it comes up. And under Obama, the issue came up, and they didn't want to challenge it because of that, because it gets into a whole lot of other questions than just mere enforcement, and their enforcement comes based on this being a classified illegal drug. So it gets into the issue is of the Constitution, state, and the federal. So it'll be a big fight, but who knows what they will do.
Yeah. So,
let's wrap up.
That's it.
Good. Thank you so much.
Thank you for coming.
So
next one is.
We have a next one scheduled, and I'm asking Dominic to look it up right now.
They are always the fourth Saturday of
the month. So always the fourth Saturday of the month, but the location might switch. So last. Oh, so right now we're scheduled for 10 a.m. here on the fourth Saturday. So we hope that you'll join us. And if there's a particular topic you want us to cover or a guest you would like us to invite, please let us know and we will, you know, our first one was focused on transportation. This was more intended as just an open Q&A. And we are always interested in having topic-oriented as well.
Thank you. And we will also be doing one with Commissioner Odorizio. It's more of a neighborhood meeting town hall at Bruce Beer's at 1675 West 67th on March 6th.
Midtown.
At 6 p.m. You know, over by Pecos.
67 Pecos.
Yeah, right around there. So we'll be doing that one. And then I'm also a member of the Legislative Latino Caucus, and we will be holding one on March 20th at 6:30 at Pipefitters as well. So anybody's welcome to come to either of those. Thank you all for coming.
Thank you.
Thank you.